Hi guys, thank you for tuning in.
Hello everyone, hello.
Oh, seven people are watching. Hi guys, welcome aboard everybody. Good morning to Sheena. Good morning everybody. Welcome aboard. Welcome aboard everyone.
Hello, hello, hello. God bless you and good evening.
Hello. Somebody saying hello, Evangelist. Okay, thank you for tuning. She says she's at work.
Okay, thank you for tuning in.
Thank you so much for tuning in. We love you. We thank you. Hi, Matthew. Bless you, man of God. Thank you so much for joining us today. Just waiting for a few more people to come on. So we have about 10 people on now.
Okay. We'll be starting in just a second.
Thank you all for joining us today. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And as you're coming on board, make sure you like this Facebook Live and make sure you share it.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Start a watch party. Whatever you'd like to do. Hi, Princess Jazzy, my friend, all the way from Canada. Love you. Thanks for joining us. Invite some friends. Invite some friends.
We'll be starting in just a second.
Just a minute. Hi, Nadia from New York. Thank you for joining us. Trying to see if I could share it from my page too for some more people to join in.
Okay. I'll give you a couple of seconds.
Okay.
And then we'll get started.
And let some other people join us this morning. This afternoon.
Yep.
Yeah. Thank you so much, guys, for joining in.
Y'all do not want to miss this interview. It took 5 months to get this interview.
Hi, Maurice Godson. Thank you so much for joining us. Hey, bless you. Jimmy Witherspoon, bless you. Thank you for joining us. If you guys could just do me a favor and start a watch party for me, that would be amazing. All right, I think we have about 15 people. You want to get started, man?
Yes, we can.
Okay.
For those of you that don't know today, Daily Ashley is a singer. She's a songwriter. She's an ordained minister, a minister of music. She has so many titles. One is controversial, and that's why I wanted to put it out today, is prophetess. We're living in a time and place where a lot of people want to call themselves prophetess or prophets. And when we noticed Minister Delia had the gift, we wanted to do an interview, which she declined at the time. This interview almost didn't even take place.
Yes.
Would you like to?
Thank you, Brachy, for starting a watch party. Sorry.
Sorry. Okay.
Thank you so very much.
Would you like to expound upon that a little bit?
So he's been asking me for this interview for months, and I kindly declined it because, believe it or not, I'm a little shy. You know, it may not look like that, but I really am. And I struggled with putting myself out there because once you're out there, you're out there. There's no turning back. There's no hiding. There's no turning around. There's no peekaboo. There's no hide and seek. Amen. You can't turn back. So bless you, Richard, man of God. And so this interview took a lot out of me to do. It took a lot. So after deliberating and after praying for a while, I just decided to just do it. Because it is time. It is time.
The devil seriously fought you on this issue.
Oh, absolutely. Yes, it was a big fight. Because, you know, as a person, sometimes, I mean, I'm a human being like everybody, and we all struggle. Instead, really, I'm shy. We all struggle with insecurities. We all struggle with our confidence. And I wasn't confident enough to think that I'm worthy or I am, you know, that I should be out there. I wasn't, bless you. God bless you both.
God bless you, God bless you, God bless you.
You know, so I just declined the interview every time.
Not only did this interview take a long time to display to get out, you had a lot of battles. We're living in a time where everybody wants to be prophets, and you ran from this title. You didn't embrace the title of media. You ran the opposite way from it.
Like, absolutely.
You didn't want to be known for the title, but you've been prophesying major events that a lot of people have no idea.
Exactly. Oh yeah, a lot of people know me because I'm a dancehall reggae gospel artist. A lot of people don't know me as a prophetess, or they know me as a minister because I'm an ordained minister, but I've been prophesying for quite a while, and my very close friends and my family know that I have this gift, but the public didn't know, and I didn't want anyone to know because this is a very heavy mantle, you know? This is a heavy mantle, and it's nothing to play with. People actually die from these type of things. So if you're not serious and if you're not living that holy life unto God, bad things can happen to you. So, I was afraid because I didn't think that, oh my God, I'm taking this up on myself.
Yes,
but
yes.
I didn't call myself. God called me. He appointed me and he anointed me and he validated me and he justified me, you know? So here I am. Here I am. God bless you, RJ, Minister RJ. God bless you, Rowan King, all the way from Jamaica. Thank you so much for tuning with us
this
afternoon.
I was back in Georgia when I contacted you first, and you had, a lot of people didn't know, but before we had the pandemic, you had a vision. You had a vision, you called me, you prophesied the whole situation. Would you like to talk a little bit about that?
Absolutely. So I had this vision, and I saw lots of dead bodies in the street, but the people looked like they were from Japan, China, Asia, that region, that part of the world. And I said, my gosh. So I called him immediately and I told him the vision, and I just saw lots of dead bodies in the street. It wasn't a bomb, it wasn't a flood, it wasn't an earthquake. They were just lying there in the street. And I said, oh my God, have mercy, you know. And shortly afterwards, the pandemic happened.
Exactly. You also had one of our, arguably the greatest basketball player to ever play basketball, to ever touch a court. Not only did you prophesy his passing, you also prophesied the exact place that he would pass.
Yes, yes. Thank you, Evangelist. Thank you.
And in two different settings you did that. You prophesied, then you came back and prophesied. And it was the second, when you came, could you please expound upon the first one with Kobe Bryant.
So I woke up one morning and it just came out of my mouth. I said, a major celebrity is gonna die. A major celebrity. God didn't tell me who. He didn't show me the person. But I prophesied that a major celebrity is gonna die. I told three people. I told him and I told two other people who can truly, truly testify to this. And God showed me where the Kardashians live. And
you said something's gonna happen around where the Kardashians, and that was Calabasas.
Right. So I was thinking that, I was saying, God, is it one of the Kardashians? But it wasn't clear. He just showed me the Kardashians. And I'm like, okay.
I quote you said the area.
The area, yes.
The area. But you didn't say what happened.
Exactly. I said the area. And I said, okay. All right, it's the area of the Kardashians. And I know that they live in Calabasas. But that was it. I didn't know anything else. Anything else.
Not only have you prophesied all these things, but we live in a time, like I said before, where everybody wants to be called themselves prophet or prophetess. And they, you know, my question is, when people are throwing titles at people, what have you prophesied? Because I've only met a few prophets in my whole life.
Yeah.
And so these are people that can come to you and tell you things that you've told no human, that you've not uttered any words to anyone. We're not talking about some things that are irrelevant, but things that are very relevant in somebody's life and something that they know that individual has been given God's inspiration to speak. And I have a scripture here from Romans 6 and 18. It says, for they that are such serve not the Lord Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. This is Romans 6:18.
Yes.
There's a lot of people that's going out here talking really good on their lives and their, but they don't have the anointing to do what very few are called to do. Where Christ says, you know, many are called but few are chosen.
Yes.
And in this situation where you have many are called but few and chosen, these people are coming about like this, say, with fair speeches and telling people that they have this gift, that they understand what can happen to them for playing with these kind of spirits and how dangerous these spirits are.
Yes, you're absolutely right, man of God. I mean, I see a lot of people, you know, they just take on the title of a prophet or a prophetess so lightly. Like, no, everybody's a prophetess these days. Everybody. And I say, my God, do they truly know what they're playing with? Do they really and truly know what they're taking upon themselves? You know, people don't really understand. I guess the title of a prophet is very popular right now. So everybody wants to be a prophetess. I saw on one young lady's page, she said, I'm just going to have to answer the call of being a prophet. So I said, how are you going to answer the call of being a prophetess? Being prophetic is a gift that God gives you. Somebody can't call you and tell you that you're a prophetess. It has to be a gift that manifests over time. You know, when I first started prophesying, I think was when John McCain was running for president. Mm-hmm. From that time, I've been prophesying, you know, and I knew he wasn't going to win. But sometimes as a prophet, you doubt yourself. You think that it's your mind. You think that, oh my God, it's an intuition. So sometimes you're afraid to say things because you think that you might be wrong, or you think that, you know, it's just your mind and people might speculate that you're not being truthful and stuff like that. You know, but you have to let the gift develop over time. It takes time to develop that gift. Just as I'm going to reference to, do you know Usain Bolt? He's the fastest man in the whole world. He's from Jamaica.
Yes.
He's been training and running for such a very long time before God put him on that big platform in Beijing to run against the worldwide most fastest men in their own countries and came out victorious to become the fastest man in the whole entire world.
Yes.
That's the same thing with the gift. You have to develop the gift. You have to pray. You have to fast. You have to seek God. You have to walk in holiness. You have to walk in righteousness. You know, it's no different. It's like a skill.
I'm glad you
except with the anointing. Except with the anointing.
I'm glad you put that out because I want to talk about, I know it said we wouldn't get personal in here and I know that you didn't want the interview to begin with.
Yes.
But,
Don't trick me. No, I'm not. That was not in the script.
But there's some things that people need to know, because with this calling comes a lot of pain.
Yes.
A lot of pain. And I know that we said that we wouldn't do this, but this is an interview. This is for people to really know who you are.
Yes.
So a lot of these people want to call themselves prophet, prophetess. They understand like some of the stuff that you would actually go through. Is it true that when you're finished praying, your body is absolutely soaked? You sweat so profusely and it's hard for you to get up and even walk.
Yes. When I'm finished praying on this Facebook Live, I'm soaked. I have to take a shower. I have to change all my clothes. I can't even get up from the seat that I'm at. I have to stay there for a while. And I know a lot of people send me messages and they want me to respond right away. But when you come off of that height of glory, I can't even stand up. I can't even walk. I have to stay there for a while. And I have to just wait on the Holy Spirit. Sometimes I'm finished with this Facebook Live and right there where I'm at, I go right into prayer again, even after praying for an hour and 10 minutes, you know? So it's like that. Prophets, some people, when they pray for people, they are on their Facebook Live, they're doing this, and the next minute, they just get up and go eat a burger and just go eat a steak. Not like nothing is wrong with eating a burger or a steak or drinking soda or whatever you want to do, or a slushy. But for me, I'm speaking from my own experience, I can't just get up and move like that. I have to wait until the Spirit is done with me, because sometimes I might be off the Facebook Live, but sometimes God is still dealing with me. You know, His power is still within me, revealing to me things about the people that I just pray with, and strategies and different types of revelations.
So
once again, let us say thank you to all our viewers.
Yes, thank you.
Minister Shakarta from out of Jamaica, powerful woman of God. Evangelist Carrion Taylor, thank you for joining us. Ryan, my spiritual son in Canada, thank you everybody for joining us. I really appreciate you guys this afternoon.
You have a prayer closet you go into. You actually have your own real prayer closet that you go into.
Yes.
And you don't spend normal times in it like most people, do you?
Sometimes I'm in my prayer closet. I'm in there for hours on top of hours. I'm talking 2, 3.
You fall asleep in your prayer closet.
I'm sure everyone on this Facebook Live, or most people, have fallen asleep in their prayer closet before. But I actually fall asleep in tongues in my prayer closet. I fall asleep just on my face. And I actually like that. I like those type of experiences, because I always get an encounter that is out of this world. I always get an encounter that is truly supernatural. So I like that. I really do.
I want to talk about something else. It says, for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. And a lot of these so-called prophets, they come out and people were asking questions too. And I want to ask one of the questions before I finish. Are you a false prophet?
Was that in the script?
No, but it's some of the questions that people ask that, you know, I want to know, and they want to know it. Tell them.
You're surprising you these questions.
Oh, sorry.
Am I a false prophet? Wow.
I mean, oh, does
no one has never asked me that before. No, I'm not a false prophet. The word of God says, out of the mouth of 2 and 3 witnesses,
every word is established.
Every word is established.
Amen.
And I've prophesied to so many people, and the things that I've prophesied have come to pass. You know, from earlier on, I noticed the type of prophet that I am. You have minor prophets, you have major prophets. God always shows me world events, catastrophes, just as though He showed me Kobe Bryant's death and the exact area that it would happen. Not like He don't speak to me about minor situations, because He does, you know, because I've ministered to so many people, and it has come to pass, and it's been accurate.
But most of your prophecies have been big prophecies.
Big one, like the Kobe Bryant prophecy.
The basketball player that died right after him.
And I told him, I said, there's also gonna be another basketball player that is gonna die after Kobe Bryant, but he's not that popular. Within 2 weeks, didn't another basketball player die?
Exactly.
But I mean, he's not big, so we didn't really hear it on a public platform.
I wanna talk about Deuteronomy 18:20. It says, but the prophet which shall presume to speak a word of God in my name, which I have not commanded to speak, or that shall speak in the name of other gods, even that prophet shall die.
My God.
This is a strong statement from God to say, if you're not called to do this, back away and take that title down out of your name.
Oh, yeah.
Because you can lead people astray, and God says, if you do this, I'm going to basically kill you for it.
Yeah, remember the false prophet, Baal, that he killed. Exactly. You know, a lot of people think that playing with the prophetic is a joke. It's not a joke. If you're going to call yourself a prophet or a prophetess, you better be ready to fight demons, or else the marine kingdom will murder you. You better be ready to fight devils of different levels.
These people have no idea what level of spiritual fights you're in right now. Even so now, they have no clue about these. And I don't know if you want to get into some of them. If you don't, I know some of them are very personal fights.
Yes.
And so, but in Matthew 7:21, it says, not everyone that saith, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. But he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. And it talks about a lot what you do, the prayers. You don't take people for granted. You go in your prayer closet for these people for real. You fight for them for real. You live the word of God out. You're practicing a lot of things in your life right now that are people, they just have no simple clue of what you're really doing to fulfill this.
Right. I mean, you know, as a young woman, I'm still growing. I'm still being enlightened. I'm still learning. I'm still evolving. So most of the things that I'm doing now in my life, I'm learning as I go along. But one thing I know and I've learned is that humility is a must. You know, the spirit of a prophet's heart must be humble. You must be prayerful. You must love people for real. You know, you must be able to give your all to people. Whether I'm teaching or I'm praying to two or three people, or if I'm teaching and praying to 800 or 900 or 1,000 people, I'm still going to give my everything. And that's, some people, they wait until the crowds are big. They wait until a big name person comes in town. But for me, I do it just the same. You know, and you have to be consistent with God. You have to be consistent with God. That is the main key.
Let me ask you another question. Are prophets accurate every time?
Okay, so he just asked me. By the way, guys, question and answer is open. If you have any question at all,
absolutely,
please feel free to write them down below. I'll answer them for you live and direct. Nothing personal, guys. So just about this topic, okay? Are prophets accurate? Always accurate. You ready for this one, guys? Okay. Prophets are not always accurate.
Very well.
Oh, no, they're not. They're not. A prophet can prophesy that, okay, you're going to get a car by the end of this year. You're going to get a white car. You end up getting a red car. The prophet is not wrong, but a prophet can be off sometimes by color. A prophet can be off by numbers. A prophet can be off by location, house or apartment. A prophet can be off by different people. They could say male or female, but a prophet is not always spot on. But one thing is for sure, the dimensions of what they're saying always lines up somehow to be true.
And we know this to be a fact because God is not a talebearer.
Yes.
And we know this because of his word. So we know that he doesn't tell all of your business out there. So what happens is he gives the prophet inclinations around what you're going through, what you're doing. And if it's a situation where you've been fighting too long and this is the only chance you may have, God may call you out on something. Because he needs your attention that very day, that very moment, that very second to save your life. I mean, that situation, he's just trying to protect you. So that is accurate. Prophets are not always spot on. And that's something people need to understand.
Exactly. Because I could give a prophetic word that restoration is coming to your house or your landlord. When you don't even have a landlord, you don't even have a house, you live in an apartment. But it's still a general covering. You see what I'm saying?
Or God can say that in few months down the line or later on, you do have that there.
Exactly.
It's because sometimes it's far off, sometimes they're closer. The prophecies, they come as is. But more important, a lot of the prophecies come when people are in need. That's when God seems to be able to move the most. And that's an area that you have been also working in very heavily with the public.
Yes. I mean, you know,
it's in money. You spent money, time that people have no idea.
People have no idea. I have spent my own money to do this. You know, I see a lot of people, they're praying and they're putting their Cash App and they're putting their Zelle and they're putting their PayPal. That's not me. I don't need anybody's money. I got my own money, honey. I don't need people's money. I'd rather to give from myself. The word of God says it's better to give than to receive. And the more you give, the more you'll get, because God is the one that is in charge of everything. And if you're making Jesus famous, he in turn will make you famous.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Amen.
I have another scripture here. It says 2 Corinthians 11:13-15, for such are false apostles, deceitful works, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. Now I'm going to repeat this again for
anybody. Repeat it again so somebody could hear. Thank you, Gloria.
2 Corinthians 11:13-15. And it says, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. They're transforming themselves. God didn't appoint them to do this. They're doing this themselves. They are transfiguring themselves into being apostles, to being prophets. And this is very, very dangerous. And I'd like to skip right forward, and because this is a very, very strong spirit. And I'd like to go where it says in Revelation 20:10, it says that, and the devil that deceived them was cast in. I want to skip forward. It says where the beast and the false prophet are.
Yes.
And it says they will be tormented day and night forever and ever.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny that it talks about the devil. Then right after that, you have the beast and the false prophet. Because we know that the devil is a mimic of God.
Yeah.
He is the opposite of God. God is light, he is darkness. And it says that he has the beast, the false prophet, and the devil. You have the three, just like you have the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
And the devil, Satan, is the destroyer, which his name is Abaddon and Apollyon, mm-hmm. which you would get the destroyer, a destroying spirit. And then you would have the beast, which is the beast within that kills. That is the one that kills. And then you have the false prophet that steals. So it's steal, kill, and destroy. And this is important, because when playing with these spirits, you entertain the spirit. The Bible says, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. It's funny that that false prophet is in there. That spirit of false prophecy is out there. And God said, hey, you're going to burn forever and ever. I'm not playing with you with this. I got prophets out here doing my work. They're doing my will. And you're out here, you're messing with people's minds.
Yeah.
You're giving fair speeches, and they're trusting in you. And God says, I didn't appoint you.
Yeah. I'm going to answer that. But I want everyone to start a watch party on your page. Share this video, because somebody needs to hear this word. Somebody who is trying to take on the title of being a prophet or prophetess needs to hear this word. It's a dangerous thing, man of God, to take on such title of calling yourself a prophet, because the word of God gives us so much warning. Not only in Revelation, it gives us so much warning of taking on these titles to ourselves, like a self-proclaimed title of being a prophet or prophetess, you know. And what did the word of God says? Isn't the false prophet going to be with the beast?
He's with the beast.
Not my word, it's the word of God.
Yeah.
So if people want to call themselves a prophet or a prophetess, just make sure that you are called.
If not, you're working in Satan's army.
Yeah.
I mean, you're literally doing more harm than good. So if y'all out there putting prophetess on, and you're not prophesying anything, and you're not prophesying anything real, you need to take that title down from your name. And this is to protect you. This isn't to say you're not called to do that. I don't know who was called in the way. That's not my... That's between you and God. You know if God called you to do something and you're just out there doing it. Or you want to be a prophet, or you want to be a prophetess, or you want to be a deacon, or you want to be, you might not should be a deacon. It might not be good for you. You might lead some of the people astray in the church because you're not ready for that office. Maybe God called you, but you're not chosen. Bible said many are called, but few are chosen.
That's right.
And so you may be called to do something, but you're not ready to do it. So if you're not ready to get out on those platforms, you shouldn't get out here and try this. Because and inevitably, you can cause God to kill you because of this.
Absolutely. I see a lot of people, because being a prophet and prophetess now is popular. Some of them just do this so they could put their Cash App, they could put their Zelle and PayPal and ask for money. I mean, the world has gotten so crazy, and the church has gotten so conflicted and topsy-turvy. Like, it's all about money now, and it's all about, oh, here's my Cash App, sow as you please, sow and let the Lord lead you. What am I sowing into?
Yeah.
We're very, very, very careful of what we sow into. We don't do those things. If God don't tell me to move, I don't move, because you sow into a person's life, next thing you know, your whole house is upside down. You lose your job. All sorts of stuff start happening in your household because you didn't sow on good ground. You sowed on a satanic and evil ground. Some of these people, I don't even know if they believe in God. But because they know that people are gullible these days and they see the game that the churches are playing and everybody wants to be a bishop and everybody wants to be a prophet and everybody wants to be a prophetess. You know, if you're not doing this for real, wrap it up.
That's why I wanted this interview so bad, because you actually ran from this title. You ran from it.
Oh, I took off. When you said, can I do an interview? I said, oh, no. No,
but
no,
you was
no.
doing this in the background.
Oh yeah,
I you just was not coming forward. With
no,
it.
No way, because
you were scared of ridicule from family, from everyone that didn't realize you had the gift because you concealed it.
Oh yeah, I hid this gift. I had this gift. I recognize this gift from I was 21 years old, and I'm not telling you guys how old I am, so don't ask. I'm in my 30s though. it started with dreams for me, and then I started seeing things that were not normal. My very first encounter is when I saw Satan. I saw Satan in real life. He manifested himself to me and I saw him clear as day. It was in the daytime, live and direct. And I was like about 12 years old, so I didn't really understand what was going on, but I knew he was the devil. I've actually seen Jesus about 3 times and actually walked with Jesus one other time, and the other 2 times he manifested himself to me. And I've seen a live angel before. I've seen an angel about twice. I've seen a real angel twice. And that from that time, I knew that I carried something special. But I never wanted to prophesy. I never wanted to do this, because being a prophet comes along with a very heavy mantle. And I said, God, no, I want a normal life. No, I want to joke around. I want to live my life. I want to sing. I want to have fun. I want to have a family. I don't want to be prophesying and preaching and teaching.
I remember you saying that.
Yeah. And every church that I go to, people would call me out. The pastor, the prophets. As soon as I go into those churches, they would just find me. I could be hiding with my head down. They would find me. And they would say, woman of God. Bless you, Althea from Jamaica. Bless you, Victoria, Uriah. Thank you so much for tuning in. They would just pick me out and say, God says you are a prophet for the nations. And I'm like, me? I'm like, God, no. So I ran from this for many years. And anywhere, any church that I go to, I would kind of just cover it up and just conceal it. I'm like, no. I'm just a worship leader. No. Until I became an ordained minister. And I say, okay, God. And then it started to get stronger and I couldn't deny it anymore. I started to prophesy who will win presidency. I started to love you, D. Lawless Divas. Love you, Victoria. Love you guys. Thank you for
tuning in.
I started to prophesy things and it would manifest and come to pass. And I said, oh my gosh, what is going on here? And God reminded me that if you run from this assignment and this mandate that is upon your life, you're going to suffer for it. And you're going to have to answer to God, and it can even cost you your life. Do you want to sit back 10, 20 years from now and look back and say, oh my God, I didn't answer your call. Look at me now. You know, because I normally wouldn't step out on a platform like this, because I don't like to let people in my personal life. And I don't like to give myself to people because I'm shy and I'm afraid of getting hurt. And I have emotions like everyone, and I have feelings, and I'm extremely emotional and I cry easy. So I didn't want to put myself out there to be rejected and just to, you know, not really be doing this effectively.
When we discussed doing this live early yesterday and getting with you on the interview, you was extremely emotional yesterday.
Yes.
Even before coming on today, there was tears, there was brokenness. Is that something a prophet carries regularly?
You know what? As a prophet, love you, Sister Shy. Love you, woman of God. As a prophet, some days I wake up very happy. Some days I wake up very emotional. Some days I wake up very sad. Some days I want to be alone. Some days I don't want to talk to anybody. And that's how a true prophet is. Some days I just don't even want to eat. But some of those things are the dynamics of a prophet. And that place is a very lonely place. You know, you might even be married, but you might even have children. You might even have a wife, a husband. But being a prophet is a very lonely place. You're very emotional about every single thing, and especially me, you know, I'm extremely emotional. And yesterday when he reminded me, said, let's do this, I said, I broke down in tears because I said, I can't do it. You know, I'll go on live and I'll pray and many people will be blessed and touched, but you know,
it's okay.
I know I'm kind of getting a little emotional.
I'm sorry. You even hid this from your church home.
Yeah. My church never ever knew that I was a prophet. And I've been there, what, Sister Shai could tell you, 3 years. And nobody knew because I don't want to put myself out there.
You really
there.
Bury this.
I bury this. I bury this. While everybody is running down this title of being a prophet and a prophetess.
You ran the other way.
I took off. I ran the opposite way. I buried this, like seriously buried it. I didn't want it at all because you're not a normal person to... when you step out to do this, people are consistently looking at you. You're now a public figure and people are gonna always watch every little move you make. And sometimes the devil and people that are on assignments and people that don't like you and people that hate you for no reason, they wanna see you fall.
Yes, absolutely.
They wanna take you down. So one bad thing or one wrong thing you say, they could use it against you. People don't think that, you know, you're a normal person and you make mistakes and, you know, you joke around and you say things sometimes that people may find offensive. So I have to constantly be checking, oh my God, is this okay? Sometimes I send him things. I said, look at this. Am I saying the right thing? Because sometimes I'm so apprehensive because I don't want to offend people. Because
growing in the gift and you're sensitive to a lot of people think that you will be, you have a lot of jealous people.
Oh, so many jealous people. So many people that don't like me. So many people that spread false rumors about me in hopes to let other people not like me. So many people.
Slick talk you on Facebook.
Oh, yeah. Throw words and throw jabs and throw javelins and throw darts. Even witchcraft. Oh, yes.
But
so many people.
But if they knew how big of a heart you really have.
Oh, thank you.
It's like it can overshadow because like you don't feel the same way behind closed doors about everyone else. You're just more direct about what you want or what you don't want. And it can be offensive to some people.
Yes, absolutely. You know, people could definitely, when a person is a strong individual and when a person knows what they want and when they're just a powerhouse, it could sometimes come off as a person being arrogant or come off as the person being cocky or come off as a person being like she thinks she's prettier than everybody. But it's not that. You know, I didn't create myself. God created me and nobody can uncreate me. I didn't anoint myself with this prophetic gift. I didn't anoint myself to be an ordained minister. I didn't anoint myself to be anything, an entrepreneur, anything that God ordained me to be. So when people see me, they think that, oh my God, look at her. Oh, this, oh, that. And they have no idea the person that I am inside. I can't help who I am, you know?
Well, I can personally know two things. I know that you're a prophet. I've watched you prophesy. I've seen everything that you say come to pass.
Amen.
I've seen you been off some, and some prophets are, but still on point in other ways. I've seen you run. 5 months you would not do this interview.
Yes.
At all.
He's been begging me. Welcome, everybody. Welcome, Soraya, Winchell, Gabriel. Thank you guys all for joining us in this session today. Yeah, so he's really been asking me for 5 months for this interview, and I run from it. I said, no way.
And refused the title. Some of your family members had thought you openly took this title.
Yeah. Yeah, my sisters, they're like, oh, please. And I'm like,
took me, others, and other people to push you to say, hey.
I love you, my sisters, Doreen. I love you guys.
Why are you running from the title? Because you consistently prophesize over and over again.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Even things in your dream. I don't mean to interrupt, but your dreams, even a lot of your dreams come to pass.
Oh, yeah. Listen, if I send you a message and I tell you that I dream that your phone is going to fall tomorrow at 3:00 and break into 3 different pieces, write it down. Mm-hmm. I think my dream is more accurate than my prophetic. Anything I dream, it always comes to pass. Whatever I dream, write it down. It's going to come through. And I think that's where it started from me. You know, it started with my dream and I realized that I would dream something. And then the next thing I'm like, I saw this. And a lot of the things... exactly. Yes, Shai. Thank you. Yeah, that's right.
Thank you, sis. Thank you.
A lot of the things, you know, that that I've encountered with dreaming and with prophesying, I would hide it from my friends and I wouldn't even tell him because I'm scared. I'm like, oh, it doesn't make any sense. And let's say I was actually on the phone. My Somebody tried to steal some money out of my bank account. This is a true story, guys. Last week, and I called the bank and they're suggesting to me to report it as a fraud. So I reported it and they said, we're gonna have to send you a new card. And I said, okay, no problem. And she said, oh, there's some here with the butterfly. I said, I need the green one. She said, the color is green. I said, oh, is it? I just chuckled to myself because even sometimes me, I surprise myself sometimes and I crack myself up because I know things before it happened. Sometimes I don't say anything and sometimes I'm thinking that, you know, I should just say it because that's quite, somebody try to call me. That's simple with a bank card, but it just makes me chuckle because I kind of know it before it happens. Can I tell them of a scenario?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, so I was working at the airport. Everybody knows what I do. I fly. But before this job, I was working at the airport. And then about three customers, they came up and they wanted to transact business. And I said, how can I help you today? Very first time. I don't know them at all. I've never seen them. In fact, they were a walk-up customer. And they said they wanted to transact business. So I said, okay, no problem. So I said, so Andre, what brings you to town? And the guy looks at his two friends and he looks at me. And he said, he didn't even give me his driver's license. He said, have we met before? I said, no. It's my first time seeing the guy. He said, so how did you know my name? I said, I don't know. The prophetic gifts, it's a little, sometimes it's very spontaneous and sometimes it's very written. Sometimes I'll say things and I don't know that I say it and I don't even know why I say it. It just comes out. So in a situation like that, that's how that worked out.
Before coming on the setting today, I'm not going to get into the situation, but you prophesied something earlier and you said that something would fall if something wasn't done. I'm not going to get into the whole situation, but we found out that was true afterwards. And this is right coming onto the set. And you said, no, you need to trust me. You need to do to add something extra to it. And I did. And if not, it would have failed. And you was absolutely right. So,
yeah.
And you was like, well, you have to learn to trust the prophetic.
Yes, you have to learn to trust the prophetic. And if you are a prophet that is watching me, or if you are a person that professes to have a prophetic ability, sometimes it's not your mind. Sometimes, bless you, man of God, that's Clayton McFarling over in Delaware. Bless you and your beautiful family.
Thank you, man of God, for
joining us this morning.
Thank you for everybody that's tuning in. This is,
yes.
I hope when y'all go back and you review this, you learn a lot from what's being taught here, especially about people and titles. And be careful who you call something. If you're going to call somebody a prophet, make sure that they're really prophesying for real.
Yeah.
Make sure they're telling you something in your life that nobody you've told but God.
Exactly.
And that's how you know a real prophet from a fake prophet.
Right, because a lot of people would prophesy. You were telling me earlier that they would know.
Oh, yeah.
Tell them the story.
They'll be like, oh, y'all, I prophesied that Sister Janine going to cook red beans and rice for the Sunday dinner. Well, she cooks red beans and rice every time you have Sunday dinner. That's not a prophecy. That's something that happens every week.
Right,
you know, exactly. You can't prophesy that Deacon Jones is going to wear blue shoes. Deacon Jones ain't got the two pair of shoes. So you know he's going to wear the blue ones or the brown ones. That's not a prophecy. That's
exactly.
He ain't got but two pair of shoes. That's all he got. Y'all buying Deacon Jones some shoes so y'all can mess up the prophecy for the ones prophesying out there. They just telling proper lies is what they doing.
That was funny. But it's actually true. You know, if you've never prophesied anything before and it has not come to pass, I'm not saying that you're not a prophet, but just recheck your channel.
Absolutely.
That you're getting information.
Absolutely.
From.
Absolutely.
Because being, like I said earlier, being a prophet, you have to walk in holiness. You have to be humble. You have to have a prior life. Because if you don't have a prior life, honey, that marine kingdom will murder you. The different devils from the higher levels, they will take you down so quick, your marriage will break apart like trouble. Everything will just become topsy-turvy and upside down in your life. So you got to be careful of what you're doing when you call yourself a prophet. You know, it's a heavy mantle. And if God didn't call you, and if God didn't appoint you and anoint you, think again before you put prophetess behind your name. Like I was telling him earlier, a lot of people, they call themselves, oh, I'm prophet this and I'm prophetess that. And, oh, yeah, what did you prophesy?
Exactly.
What did you prophesy that has come to pass? Anybody could speak into people's life and say, whoever's watching me, I see God healing, I see God touching you. Everybody needs a healing these days. Everybody needs a touching these days. But when you prophesy to someone, is your daughter going to be adopted? Your daughter's going to be adopted. She's studying medical, and the person say yes. That's a real prophet.
Yes.
That's a real prophet, you know?
And it's not just that. It's more than being a prophet. It's being obedient. You're very obedient to the word of God.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Very obedient. And,
yeah.
And a lot of people, you know, they jump up and they live in every day like they went right back into a life like the gospel never existed.
Yeah.
As soon as they get up from their lives. You don't live your life like that. I know personally that you do not live your life like that.
No.
I also know that you do not, for anybody watching, she did not give herself this title. She ran from this title. It took me and others to say, hey, pick up your mantle and walk.
Yeah.
You know, God's called you. She knew she had the gift without a doubt.
Yes.
But it was not something she was willing to tell even her own church members.
Yeah.
She kept it completely buried.
Yeah, completely buried. I mean, you could ask people from my church, they're on this live. Nobody in my church knew this about me because I
and
just...
And they're wonderful people.
Oh, they...
Wonderful people.
Love my church family. First Lady Diane Oscar, Bishop Oscar Lewis, I love you guys.
Yeah, love y'all guys. And I hope y'all watch this and learn a lot too about the members that you have. And maybe we can learn to expound upon the gifts inside of the people.
Yeah.
Figure out what they have and what's inside of them. You know, our gifts and crafts are used for each other to the enjoyment. And God give you these gifts for his own enjoyment and to use your gift to deliver other people.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So it's not something to really play with, you know, because what if God puts you on a platform and somebody gives you a mic and say, go ahead, man of God, go ahead, woman of God, prophesy. Then you're stuck like a truck. Because you are not a real prophet. You are a false prophet professing to be a prophetess or a prophet, you know? And speaking in tongues and rabba shatadaba, and I declare that a blessing is coming. That's not really being a prophet. You prophesy something and you watch it come to pass. You declare
and you
this.
You do this effortlessly.
Oh, effortlessly, because God has anointed me to do this. I didn't choose this. I didn't choose myself.
Well, like I said, I personally know that you did not. And even upon everyone pushing you, despite what family, friends, church members may think, you did not even want this title.
No
seriously,
way.
You almost refused it for 5 months. You would not even give me the interview. You wouldn't do anything. And I wanted people to know who you really were.
Yeah, and he's been begging me. And I said, no, I'm not putting myself out there. I'm not doing this interview. I'm not declaring or professing nothing. I'm just going to let God have his perfect way and let God do his perfect will. And that's where we are.
I want to read this again to the followers that are coming in.
Thank you guys for coming.
Yes.
Sarah, Carlene, greetings everybody.
I want to
bless you guys for coming in.
Yes, thank you so much for coming in on the live. We really appreciate you. In Deuteronomy 18:20, it says, but the prophet which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded to speak, or that shall speak in the name of any other gods, even that prophet shall die. This is nothing to play with. For people that's out here thinking you can just call yourself whatever and not really caring about what they are. You know, be cautious to call people that in your church home. Don't call people prophet so-and-so and apostle so-and-so if they're not really a prophet of the Lord.
Yes.
If they're not really a prophet of the Lord. Because what's going to happen is you're pushing them to be something that God has not ordained or called them to be.
Absolutely.
The Bible says the anointing destroys the yoke. The yoke is what's around your neck choking you to death.
Yeah.
And God said that anointing can break that off of you.
Amen.
But if you don't have an anointing to break that off of somebody, you do yourself and them more harm. All you is a pool of Satanism.
My God, go ahead, man of God.
Because you don't have that anointing to break something off of somebody.
Mm,
the anointing destroys the yoke. It just tears it down. It breaks it apart.
Amen.
And if you don't have this and you go out here and you tell the people, hey, I'm a prophet, I'm doing, and they're running you because they need help.
Yeah.
And you can't help them. What you're doing is prolonging somebody that can actually come to them and really help them. That's why God said, if you do this to my people, I'm going to kill you for it.
My God.
Because I got to get them out of your way. So if they stuck up under you and they still believe in you, then I'm going to have to remove you to get them to somebody that can help them.
My God.
Because Christ makes a statement. He says, I will not leave you, but I will come to you.
Yes, amen.
So I'm not going to leave you in this dead church here with this prophet lying to you every day and can't help you. Don't have an anointing. You're still in the same situation. You've been in the church 17 years and you still have the same problems. because there's no anointing there. There's no real anointing to break anything off.
My God, you're teaching, man of God.
And
go
so
ahead.
These people will go to church and they'll say, well, hey, I'm here because, you know, their grandmother baked sweet potato pies for their church, or their aunt used to go to this church, and the church was felt like a good place as a kid to go. It doesn't mean it has an anointing there.
My God, that's
true. You need to go to a place that has an anointing, and you have that anointing.
Amen.
You actually have that anointing. And when people go into a church home, they need you there.
Yeah.
You're a bigger pillar than what you need. And that's why so many of us push you. You're not just a prophet. You've prophesied in my life.
Yeah, I have.
You prophesied. Man, we could go on for days. We don't have enough live footage.
Yeah. You know, actually, you know, being a prophet sometimes, bless you, Fuda. Thank you so much for joining us. Bless you, Carlene.
Thank you
guys for all joining in. Okay, everybody that's on here, if you could just start a watch party for me, that would be amazing. Because people need to hear this message. People who try to take on titles and mantles that they have no business with, they need to know that they're treading on dangerous grounds. And they need to know that they can't play with God, and you can't play with fire. You'll get burned. You can't play with the devil.
And you're not doing this because you want to see anybody failing, take down their lives. When I talked to you before, this was not about bashing people. In fact, you had the whole opposite demeanor, that you really love these people.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. I mean, you know, my heart is just moved because I see so much foolishness going on Facebook, and so many people are praying and they're glorifying themselves instead of glorifying God, and they want to put their brand out there in their name, and nothing is wrong with that. But when it comes down to the work of God, God says in his words that he's going to separate the sheep from the goats. And let me tell you something, when God separates the sheep from the goats, honey,
amen,
it is what it is.
Amen.
So you can't play around with God and expect God not to stand upon his word.
Or really live the word out, because in the scripture we read earlier expounds upon that very situation where those who are doing this are also living the word of God, and you actually live this word.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, you know, being a prophet, somebody asked me the other day about, oh my God, so you're a prophet and nobody knew about you. The word of God says when Samuel went to Jesse to find the next king, right? Jesse brought out all his sons. And Samuel said, not this one, not that one, not that one, not that one, not that one. Well, Jesse said, well, so Samuel said, wait, this is not it. Do you have any more sons? And Jesse said, you know what? Yeah, I have a little one on the backside of the desert tending to the sheep. Yeah, David. Samuel said, bring him. That's the one that I want. So a lot of you that are watching me on this Facebook Live, God has you on the backside of the desert in training. God has been have you there. You've been on the backside of the desert for a long time. And God had you there to birth humility in you, to birth a good character in you, to birth an unusual anointing in you, to birth strength in you, to birth confidence in you. And when God finally lifts you up and put you on display, you have a lot of people that are going to say, where did she come from? Where did he come from? You know, a lot of people are going to say, oh, no, she's just a singer. She's not even a prophet. And they're not going to want to receive from you. And they're going to want to start to spread rumors and lies on you. And they're going to want to start saying all manner of evil against you. Like, oh, everybody's a prophet. Oh, look who's doing this now. When in reality, you have been in training for a very long time, and people don't know that. I have been in training for a very long time, fighting bears, lions, tigers, all sorts of demons, you know, on the backside of the desert for God to bring me to this place. Now, fighting my own fears, my own emotions, my own confidence.
If people knew your real story of your whole life, they would really not even believe it.
Oh, no. Oh,
the kind of battles you face are unprecedented.
Oh, they wouldn't believe it. They wouldn't believe that at night demons try to come in and fight me.
Because they see the polished you.
Exactly. You guys see the polished me, the anointed me. But when I'm on my face and demons are coming to attack me, because the devils know what God is doing and they don't like it, because they know that through my voice, through the prophet's mouth, people are healed, people are set free, people are delivered, lives are transformed, situations are changed, chains are broken, mountains are moved. The devil doesn't want that. So he attacks you. But you know what he does also, man of God? Before you even get started with this, the devil will go from way back and try to set up this whole arena against you for people to not like you. for people to look down on you, for people not to want to be your fan or your friend or your follower. That's how the devil works before God starts a thing. But God is the one that establishes, he anoints, he promotes, and he justifies. So when God puts you up there, no one can take you down. And the word of God says that promotion cometh neither from the east nor from the west, but promotion comes from God. So when God promotes you, who can unpromote you?
I think it's very vital that you brought this up because in Christ's hometown, people got so familiar with Christ. Would you like to talk about that? You spoke about it before, but they got so familiar, said Christ couldn't even do many miracles in his own town because Everybody got so familiar with him.
Right, the spirit of familiarity. That spirit will cause you not to receive from someone in your own household, from someone in your own church,
come on, woman of God,
from someone even at your workplace, from someone, from not
Amen.
Even a baby.
Amen.
You know, the word of God says the gift is without repentance. So it doesn't matter if you see a person, they did this last week and you hear them saying this next week. God can still use that person because God will use whomever he chooses. And when you get so familiar with people, it's like you tend to forget that God is sovereign and that God is ultimate. And he does very unique things because he's God and he's very strange. You know, John the Baptist was in the wilderness and he ate locusts and wild honey. I don't know about any of you that are on this Facebook Live, but a lot of you people today, you would not want a man to preach to you that eat locusts. You know what locusts are? It's like those giant wasps. You would call it a wasp.
Mm-hmm.
That's all he ate. That's all John the Baptist ate. I know a lot of you know the scriptures, but you wouldn't want to receive from John the Baptist just because he's like that. And he probably barely wore clothes just to cover up his private areas. But it's like people have an image of what they want to receive from.
Very,
you know?
True. Very true.
Yeah, they have an image. If you don't come and say, and God. Like, people don't want to receive from you if you can't hoop and holler. But what about that little person who said, my sister, my brother, hear he the word of the Lord.
Amen. Come on, teach them.
God says to tell you this. God says to tell you that. I'm speaking into your life. Do you want to hear from those people? Whether they're a simple person or they're a powerhouse. You know, you can't get too familiar with people that you miss the mark. And that's what's wrong with a lot of people, man of God. They miss the mark.
We had a talk a little under a year ago. And
yeah.
We talked about making sure no matter if that's your husband or your wife out there, or that's your brother, your sister, I don't care what you're going through, make sure you respect the office of that person.
Yeah. I have people who come in my inbox. Hey, Dahlia. I'm like, okay. What's up? I mean, I would never approach my bishop or my first lady or my pastor like that, or an evangelist or a person with a title, you know? What's up, John? What's up, Tom? What's up, Harry? I would never approach a person like that. So understanding what person is vital, you know? And you just have to know the call that's on the person's life and just respect the anointing.
Amen.
Amen.
I got a couple more questions for you. What do you think about when you're trying to put this word out? And I know this was a hard one for you today because you being bashed all your life doesn't want to bash anyone.
Yeah.
That's something you really want to destroy away from.
Yeah.
That's something you pushed far away from. And you didn't want to bash anybody. You wanted everybody to know that this was actually done in love.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Because he's been asking me for 5 months now to do this interview. And I said, hi, Julie. All the way from California. Bless you.
Hey,
thank
Julie,
you so
how you doing?
Much.
Thank you for tuning in.
Thank you for tuning in with us, Julie. I hope your procedure went well, and we're praying for you, and we love you. Thank you so much again. Respect the anointing. Yes, that
Hallelujah.
Is absolutely true, Carlene. That is absolutely true.
Hallelujah.
You know, this is not to bash anybody. This is to help somebody, actually.
Because they can die.
Oh, yeah. This is to help somebody. If you're not a prophet or a prophetess, don't give yourself that title, because this is trodding on dangerous grounds, as I said earlier. And the word of God says you can actually die from this. You know?
Yes.
You could actually die from this, because when you play around with something that you know nothing about, when you play around with something that is bigger than you, you know, you go into realms and different levels that have different devils. And if you don't know how to fight those demons, and if you're not equipped, if you're not prepared, those demons will kill you and disrupt your finances and disrupt your family.
Absolutely.
And your marriage, and just turn everything into a hot mess.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So it's definitely something to think about, like I was talking earlier, and I saw this person wrote on their Facebook that, oh, I'm just gonna go be a prophetess. I guess I gotta go be one. How would you guess you gotta go be one? I don't know. You know, I just don't understand it. I've been running from it for years until God finally backed me up and said, enough is enough. God said, I've called you, I've anointed you and appointed you, and you're gonna do what I want you to do. Listen, it's like I'm a prisoner. Like God just backed me up and said, Dahlia, go. And I finally say, okay, God, okay.
Yeah, you cried about this. You cried about actually having this office. You literally cried about it.
Oh yeah. I called him one day and I was crying and I said, I don't want to be a prophetess. I don't want to prophesy to people. I just don't, it's just too much. And he encouraged me. He said, whatever God has called you to be, that's what you are. Go forth. And I said, okay. I prayed about this. I fasted about it. Because a lot of people that I encounter, they don't know that I have this gift. Yes, that's right, Evangelist Charles. Yeah, you're right. Promotion only comes from God. A lot of people, they don't know that I have this gift. Like I said, they know me to be a singer, worship leader, minister, a reggae gospel artist. But nobody knew that I actually had this prophetic gift. And, you know, just like you develop anything and just like you grow, I'm still growing in this gift.
Can we please talk about that? About growing in the gift. A lot of people don't know that anything that you work at, being a minister, you know, T.D. Jakes talked about standing in the mirror and repeating what he was going to do and really practicing at the gospel. And this is no different. You're it's a skill trait as well.
Yeah.
You polish it up as time goes on. You get better and better. And you get sharper in your mind. The more you fast, the more you study, the more you pray. Could you please explain
about it? I was just about to say that a lot of people think that sharpening your prophetic gift and your prophetic ability is you try to say, oh yeah, let me just tell this person this. No. It's actually praying, fasting, staying in the face of God, staying on your belly, turning down your plate, putting away food. That's what sharpening your gift is. It's not about who you could tell this to, because if you're not a real prophet, if you're a false prophet, oh, time will tell on you. Time is the master of all things, and time will tell if you're a false prophet. You know, so you actually have to live a holy and consecrated life. Stay in the face of God. You know, pray, fast, seek God. You actually have to do that to sharpen your gift.
We're so lucky to get this live, because a lot of people didn't know she's in fasting right this minute.
Oh yeah, I'm on a 7-day fast.
So it's like pulling teeth to get her to do the interview.
I haven't eaten anything all day, as beautiful as I look. Amen.
So you having the gift and being able to polish the gift up as time goes on, and fasting and studying and reading and learning in the gift. Is this a fun attribute? Because I know you carry the weight of other people's burdens on you.
Oh yeah. I have so many people that has messaged me on Facebook. People from Africa, Jamaica, New York, Canada, Florida, Tennessee. People from Orlando, all over. Thank you. People from all over. And I have to be staying on my face with those prayer requests. Sometimes I can't even find time for myself to do anything. You know, I can't even find time for myself to even scratch my head. I'm like, okay, I gotta pray for this. I gotta stay on top of this. And on top of that, I have a personal life. You know, I work a full-time job. I have a business. I'm an entrepreneur. I'm a minister at my church. I'm the minister of music. I'm a worship leader. You know, and I have a relationship. So I have to find time for myself too. And sometimes I don't find that time, you know, because I'm busy interceding on the behalf of other people.
All of the time.
All the time, not only some of the time. For all those of you who are joining us, thank you for joining us. Ophelia, bless you, woman of God.
Thank you.
Everybody else that's joining us, we love you. Thank you for joining with us today. If you could just go ahead and do me a big favor and start a watch party on your page, because Thank you, Gloria. Hi, Gloria. A lot of people need to hear this message, that they shouldn't play with the title of a prophet or a prophetess. It's not a joke, and it's not a game, and it's not, you know, they shouldn't play with this, because it could be deadly, right?
I'm going to say this again for the newcomers coming in. This will be the third time. Deuteronomy 18:20 says, but the prophet which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded to speak, or that shall speak in any other God's name, even that prophet shall die.
Mm-hmm.
Be careful what you do out here. Be careful what you call yourself.
Yeah.
If you're not a minister, don't call yourself a minister.
Yeah.
God has not appointed you to be a minister. Don't do it. Just lay low until he gives you
that. Exalts you. That's right.
And that don't mean that you won't have it. It just means that maybe not now. Maybe not till you're ready. You know, what God wants to do is what God ever does. We have no control over that.
That's right.
But you'll know when God calls you. You'll know when you have that anointing to break yokes. You know, out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, and the same thing with you. Like I said, you didn't have this prophetic. You did not choose this gift. This gift actually really chose you.
Absolutely. Like we were talking earlier, and he was telling me that I actually ran away from this interview. Like, I'm always running. God has been calling me to do this for a long time, and I kept on running and running and running because it's a heavy responsibility. It's a heavy mantle, and it's a big responsibility when you have people's life in your hand to pray for them and pray for their families and intercede on their behalf. So if you have no prayer life, if you're not living a consecrated life before God, and bless you, Naomi, thank you for joining us. If you're not walking in the will of God and living according to his word, yes, exactly, Fuda, yeah. If you're not living according to his word, how are you gonna pray for people? How are you gonna deliver them? How are you gonna speak a prophetic word into their lives? Demons will kill you. They will eat you up and chew you and spit you out like candy. You know, you got to be careful what you're playing with. You got to be careful.
Yeah, the Bible says this is very, very serious. And it talks about a lot to do with the strong spirit, which for those of y'all just tuning in, you know, you have a scripture that expounds upon that in Revelation 20:10. It says, and the devil that deceived them was cast out into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So that false prophet is a spirit. For those that don't know, it is a spirit. And the spirit can come upon you for false prophecy because you're not called. So if you're not called by God, then you're doing the devil's work.
That's right.
And it says, for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because if it's a peaceful resolution to what he gives you, if you can give somebody that and they can get delivered and have that peace that they need, if they took 6 months from now, you prophesied, they're still in the church doing the same thing and nothing's changing in their life, it's because you're anointing. It said the anointing breaks the yoke.
Amen.
It breaks what's strangling you to death. So Amen. Just remember this. Keep this in mind. It's what's keeping you afloat.
Yeah. That is right.
And you know about this because you have people's life in your hands all the time.
Oh, yeah. People from all over the world. A lot of things.
Literally all over the world.
Yeah. A lot of things I don't put on Facebook. I don't publicize it. Because naturally, I know some of you may not believe, but you just wanted to sing. Exactly, Fuda. That's right. A lot of people may not know this, but I'm actually very shy. You know, I don't know if this ever happened to anybody, but I don't like to hear my own voice. Sometimes it annoys me and I get annoyed, you know, because sometimes I'm like, oh my God, I just feel nervous sometimes, but I don't like to hear myself play. Ask him. Sometimes he's playing stuff and I'm like, oh my God, I don't want to hear it, because that's how a true prophet or a true teacher, preacher is. Some of them, not everybody. Some people would love to listen to themselves over and over, and that's good. I'm still working my way up to that confidence level, but sometimes I don't like to hear my voice, you know, because I'm very critical of myself, you know?
Let's talk about a point that you talked about before, about sometimes it's not even about that. Your prophetic mind is somewhere else. Soon as that's over, you're in another place already.
Oh, yeah. A lot of the times he's having conversations with me, and it's not even me. Like, I'm gone to another place. And we spoke about earlier that when I get off the Facebook Live and praying for everybody out there that watches me, I'm soaked. You could ask him. Well, I take a picture and I send to him and I said, look at this. I'm soaked and I have to change clothes, take a shower, because when I go
and it's hard for you to walk.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes when I sit down, I can't even move. Sometimes the spirit just has me there. And after I'm done praying for an hour and 10 minutes on Facebook Live, I'm on my face, on my knees for another hour. I just had in my prayer closet for another 2 hours. And, you know, people message me and they're like, thank you, pray for me. And I can't really answer them at that time. Because sometimes for hours, I'm on my face before God after, you know, I finish with the Facebook Live.
Now, every human being likes attention in the world. We don't do things so people don't see us.
Yeah.
That's just a fact of matter. That's a life situation. So everybody loves to be seen. I love to be seen.
Yeah.
I like to be seen. I don't put on decent clothes just for me to see myself in these clothes. I put them on because I like to look decent, and I hope that people can see that I like to look decent.
Yeah.
You see? And so a lot of people would also think that you just do everything for attention. And that's not really the case. If people actually took the time to really know Dahlia Ashley, attention is great.
Thank you, Fuda.
But your anointing and your gospel, man, that is serious. Your word is serious. And if somebody doesn't know, if they're not with you all the time, or they don't know you long enough, they don't realize how much you really honestly stay on your face before God.
Yeah.
So that few seconds they get to see you or post some food or do something, that is just your little few moments of enjoyment.
Yes.
To what you're working all the time. And you made this statement yesterday that I think after this, if I take the mantle entirely, that I'm not going to have no time for me.
Yes. I was actually telling him, I said, you know, if I take on this mantle officially, my personal life will kind of go down. And for those of you who know me, I love to have fun. I love to travel. I've been to many countries in the world. I have a lot more to embark on. You know, I want to go to Egypt. I want to go to Thailand. I want to do this. And I'm like, well, if I have to do this Facebook Live, and if I have to do that, and if I have people who are depending on me, then my personal life is going to go dim. And, you know, I was telling him how worried I am about those things, because people see the glory, but they don't know my story. They don't know how many years I've suffered and struggled with low self-esteem, with my confidence, you know, with putting myself out there. I would never have done this if God really didn't ordained it, you know, because they see me now, and they're all saying, well, we didn't know that she was a prophet. It's not for you to really know. It's for God to promote what he wants to promote, because promotion comes from him. Right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's him that magnifies you, not you. You don't go out there and magnify your voice for 100,000 people. He does that.
Right.
He entirely does that for you. If you sang gracefully that day, and if you've ever heard a powerful hymn or a powerful song, you know what it is. You understand why there's 30, 40 million views on there. It's because that gift was magnified for him.
Absolutely.
It could be magnified for the devil too. In just the opposite direction.
Yeah, you're right.
So it's not like the devil couldn't be magnified in the same setting.
Yeah.
So
everybody that's watching, do me a favor, please, and start a watch party on your page, or share this video so we can get the word out there that if you're going to call yourself a prophet or a prophetess, be very careful, because this is not something to joke with.
Yes, know the word. That is a strong spirit to play with. So really know your word when you decide, especially that title, prophet, because it's linked directly. Once again, we told earlier, the devil, which is Satan, is the destroyer. The beast is the one that kills, and the false prophet steals. Kill, steal, kill, and destroy. It's
absolutely
like the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but the opposite of that.
Amen.
So you're working in a whole spiritual realm of evil when you play those games. So please be mindful of that when you're calling yourself these titles, whether it's bishop, prophet, especially the word prophet.
Thank you, Dahlia.
That's why this live was done. And it's not to hurt any. I don't want any of y'all to feel like, oh my God, she's talking about us. Hey, hit dog or holler. If this is you and you know you need to take that title off your name, don't be ashamed to take that title off your name.
Yeah.
Look, this thing said you can die. The Bible says you can die. The word of God says you can be killed for this. Don't wait till God kills you and takes you out because you're prophesying.
Right.
To somebody. And you're misleading people.
Absolutely.
And then you end up in a car wreck and you're something and you're dead because of it. That's why she did this. She did this to protect you, not to hurt you, not to make you feel some type of way.
Absolutely.
Because the minute you put up that you were a prophetess and people seen the, especially the last prayer you did, one of the most powerful prayers I've ever heard.
Glory to God.
And you seen titles pop up everywhere after that.
Oh yeah, I've never seen some people with prophet and prophetess behind their name all of a sudden. But don't get me wrong, guys. Listen, the word of God says you must covet good gifts. Nothing is wrong if you see a person doing something and you like what they do and you want to do it like them. Listen, the word of God says go by the byways and the highways. And that's what we all should be doing anyway. We should all be trying to win souls for Christ. All I'm saying is, make sure that you're standing on God's word. Make sure that you're living a holy life. Make sure that you're in the word of God. Make sure that you're staying on your face. Make sure that you have a prayer life, because if not, the devil will kill you.
Yes. life.
And those demons will come after you. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, because you're open season for the devil. Once you go this far, you're open season for the devil. Absolutely. When you decide that you don't want to do this no more, or you decide that you want to do it and you're not called to do it, you're entertaining spirits unaware.
Absolutely.
And these are not good spirits you're entertaining.
Thank you, Gloria. Appreciate your feedback.
And they have a right to you once you start lying and carrying on. They have a right to torment you.
Absolutely.
So we don't want saints out there being tormented. If you're not a prophetess and you want to be a good minister, be a good minister.
Yeah.
If you know you're called to be a minister, be a minister. Don't be a minister trying to be a prophetess. Right. She did not take this title lightly. She did not take it herself. She did not give herself this title.
No
For
way.
Anybody that does not know this, she did not give herself this title. It took me and many others. The Bible said out of about the two or three witnesses, every word is established.
Yeah.
And until she knew that for sure, she would have never, I know she would have never took this title.
Never.
Never took the title up.
No way. Because I understand the severity. I understand the weight. I understand the responsibility of having people's lives in your hands to pray on their behalf and to, you know, just storm the throne of heaven on their behalf. And it's not an easy mantle. And I know a lot of people may be saying, who said you are a prophet and who said you are a prophetess? Out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, right, every word is established. So if God has called you, anointed you, and appointed you, and validated you, go forth in Jesus' name. Go forth.
But to tell the truth about this, you've been prophesying this a lot through your life.
Yeah.
You just now deciding to do this.
One of the last prophetic words I've gotten is two people actually. They said to me, they said, God is going to use you all over Africa to prophesy and to heal. You're going to heal sick. You're going to do all sorts of great things for God. And I say, God, you know I'm shy. You know I stutter. My tongue get twisted. I'm like, all the time. You know, I get emotional sometimes. I get afraid, you know, because it's not an easy thing to carry. It's not an easy thing to carry. And sometimes I try to run away from it. But the more I run away, the more God keeps talking to me. Right after I was finished with the Facebook Live on Saturday, someone from Africa, they messaged me. And they started to speak into my life. And she started to say that, my sister, God is going to lift you up so much. All over Africa, Asia, Europe, your name will be known. Your name will be great. She said, anybody that's on board with you right now, they better stay on board. Because the world is coming. The nations are going to welcome you. And right there and then after that Facebook Live, I broke down. And the Holy Spirit just kept on going and going and going. It took me about another an extra 2 or 3 hours to just finally calm down and to just, you know, simmer down in the spirit. Because the person was just prophesying to me. And this is nothing new to me. It's things that I know. But because I've run from it for so long, and it's finally coming to pass, you know, it gets me a little nervous sometimes. But, you know, I'm still growing. I'm still learning. I'm still evolving, man of God. You know?
Well, this has been up over an hour. I want to conclude. Are we going to get a second interview from you?
A second interview?
Because we don't have enough time.
No, we've been on an hour?
Yes.
Oh, wow. So he's been asking me for this interview for 5 months. And this is an hour. And it took everything out of me to do this interview because I don't like to put myself out there. You know, and I'm very private. He could tell you. I have a few of my friends on here. They could tell you that I'm very, very private.
So we're going to get a one-on-one part two.
Do you guys want a one-on-one part two? Let me know. Let me see. 7 people say yes. Okay, well, Julie already said, if 7 people say yes, then I'll think about doing it. If 7 people say yes, I'll think about doing it.
God's perfect number.
If 7 people say yes, I'll think about doing a one-on-one. All right, so only if 7 people. Okay, so
we got 2.
Julie said yes. Victoria
said
yes.
Come on, guys. Come on. We need a second interview. Yes,
Charles said yes. Oh, my gosh. Okay, so let's see. How many is that? 1, 2, 3. Okay, yes. That's about 5. Yes. Delia said yes. Okay.
Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Yes. Part 2, please. Okay.
Hallelujah. We will get a part 2. We have a lot of questions. There's a lot of things I didn't get to get into in this with her. And I got to open
okay,
up.
Okay, okay, I'll do it, guys. I'll do it. So many people are saying yes.
So we'll
okay,
get a part
I'll
two.
Do it. I'll do a part two.
Thank you for tuning in, and I'm gonna let you finish that. Normally I would lead out, but I want you. I know that this was personal to you, and I know that you didn't want to bash anybody doing this.
They said we need more.
So please let them know how would you like to conclude it.
Well, I'd like to conclude to let you know. Thank you, guys. You guys are sweet.
Y'all are awesome. Thank you.
I want to let you guys know that if God has called you, and if God has appointed you and anointed you, be confident in who you are.
Hallelujah.
Be confident. You're welcome, honey. Be confident in who you are. You know, a lot of the times our past stigmas, low self-esteem, non-support from family, friends, from your spouse, that could cause you to not want to rise up and do what God has called you to do. But I want you to be confident this morning. And two, if God has called you to do something, you can't worry about what anybody's saying. You got to just be confident in Him, knowing that He is the one backing you. And you could go ahead, man of God.
Thank you. For those of you out there that want to take up these titles, please understand how serious the title you're taking up. In Malachi, it talks about, you know, pastors and stuff are being judged worse at the end of their life because they had responsibility to God.
Yeah.
And if you go and lead people astray with that responsibility, your punishment's going to be even worse.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So you don't want to walk out of here with a worse punishment because you wanted to play with the title. If you're just a minister, be a minister.
If you're just an intercessor, be an intercessor. If you're just a pastor, I mean, I'm not saying that you're not anointed to do that, but just, you know what you're doing.
Even the deacons need to be anointed. They need to have the right people skills.
Yeah.
The right know-how to bring people in and gracefully sit them down. To me, the deacon is just as important as the pastor. Everybody plays a role in God's movement here.
Amen.
So make sure that when you're moving by working faith, and you absolutely know that you're called to do what you're called to do.
Amen.
And for those of you using the word prophet, remember that if you're not called to be a prophet, and if, let's put it that you are. Let's say you are called to be a prophet.
Because a lot of us are called.
Exactly. Yeah. But you may not be chosen. And that's the other part of that. You need to be called and chosen. So if you're not chosen and you know you're not chosen and God's not working through you in this gift the way you think that He's supposed to, don't play with it because you can end up dead.
Yeah.
You don't want something to happen to you. You have children, and you have a mother that loves you, and a family, and a brother, and an uncle, and people that may care about you and love you, but God's not going to play about this.
Yeah.
So when you decide to go play in the ministry, you can cause yourself to die really quickly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I don't want this to happen to nobody. I don't want somebody out there saying, oh my God, this happened to Sister So-and-so. This is what can happen. I'm telling you. He's saying, I got people really hurting. And I'm sending real ministers of the gospel to them. People like Dahlia Ashley is a prophetess, and they're going to send her to them to help them, to bring them out, to destroy that yoke, let that anointing destroy that yoke. It may be a song. It may be something she can't sing for the person.
Amen.
Maybe another anointing has to do it.
That's right.
So you have to use that anointing to break that yoke. It's going to take that song to break that yoke.
Amen, man of God. Amen.
So
yeah.
In knowing this, just understand, be who you are and be proud to be whatever. If you're a deacon and never a minister, be proud to be a deacon.
Hallelujah.
Be absolutely proud to be in God's house.
Yes.
Don't think of yourself, I should be a minister. No, if you're not the minister, then you're the minister's man. You're him. He needs you. He needs you to get his water and to wipe his head. Put that cloth in your pocket. Get a blessing by
it. Hey, go ahead.
Hey, my God. But don't take and think that you need to be the pastor.
Yeah.
I'm not a prophet. I don't need to be the prophet. You see what I'm saying?
Amen.
If God lets us prophesy as preachers, then we just prophesy. That doesn't make us a prophet either.
That's right. Amen.
It means He may give you that for the moment to prophesy to somebody. That doesn't make you a prophet of God.
Amen.
I tend to be a minister of God. Amen. Not a prophet. I'm not going to be a prophet because she's a prophet. I can't be that. I can only be a great minister.
Amen.
That's what God told me that I would be a great minister.
Amen.
Not a prophet. is a lesser office than her? No, we all work in the kingdom of God together.
Amen.
So if you got these titles on your page, take those titles down. If you're not a minister, take it down. If you're not a prophetess, take it down. If you're not prophesying, you say you're a prophet, take it down.
Amen.
Quit being these things you're not called to be.
Amen. Amen.
We love you. We thank you. God bless you. And we'll see you on the next part two.
Part two, because you guys asked for it. We're going to do keep going, spiritual food. We've been on over an hour. But for those of you who are asking for more, we're going to be doing a part two. I'm not sure if it's going to be next week, Monday, but look out for the flyers, guys. Look out for it.
Yeah, watch for the flyers. They'll be up.
Yeah, and we're going to let you know when we're going to be on again to just give you guys some more knowledge and some more insights, because these things are really necessary.
I know there's some people hurt by this too, and we just want to say we love you.
Yeah.
We love you. This wasn't to hurt you today. This wasn't to knock you down or to make people say, oh, she took that title down. When you take that title down, it's because you don't want to die, because you're being obedient to God.
That's right.
Be obedient to the Lord. If you know that's not you, don't leave those titles on your page. Don't do that because you've seen somebody and think, hey, this could be a good money thing for me.
Yeah.
One thing I know for you is you spend your own money for
stuff. I spend my own money. I don't put Cash App, I don't put Zelle, I don't put PayPal, I don't have to do that. I make money and I have my own money.
And people don't know in the future they will be able to pour into your ministry. And
the great
thing about it is they don't really don't know your heart.
Yeah.
They don't really know what you'll do with this money and actually prove to Facebook users what you're doing with it.
Exactly.
Your heart is like
I donate to charities. I do so many great things. And all over the world.
That people don't even know.
People don't even know, they don't have a clue. Love you guys also. They don't have a clue. They don't know.
It's nothing for me to walk to another personal minister and give them $100.
It's nothing for me to give them $300. I just did that last week. To just call up someone and say, I'm sending $100 to you. I'm sending $200. Check your Cash App. I'm sending. It's nothing. I do it all the time. All the time. I love to sew.
Absolutely. Well, thank y'all. We appreciate you being on. And we'll see you on part two. Make sure you tune in.
Thank you guys for joining.
And share this with everybody that you know.
Yes. Thank you, Julie. Bless you guys, Philip, everyone for joining in. Thank you so much, Victoria, Christy. We appreciate you guys greatly. Thank you so much. And we will see you guys on part two, because you guys asked for it. And I can't wait.
Amen.
But first of all, wait, do you guys have any questions before we get off?
Does anybody have any questions, period?
Does anyone have any questions? Okay, I'm going to give you 3 minutes. Only 3 minutes. If anyone want to ask any questions, we will answer them right now, right here, on the spot. All right, I'm giving you 2 more minutes to ask questions. Anyone that have any
Tanya
questions?
Tanya Thompson, thank you for tuning in.
Hi, Tanya.
We're fixing to conclude the video, but if you go back and watch it, we greatly appreciate it. Thank you so much.
I will remember in prayer, Philip. Bless you. Faith, thank you for tuning in. We're just finishing up. You guys could go over and rewatch the video again from the beginning. Okay, so nobody have any question? And 1 more minute. Oopsie. How much do you know what God wants to do
to
you?
We love you too, Gloria.
Look at the question that Julie asked. You know what? With all the prophetic words that I've gotten, I've heard that God is going to use me all over Africa, Asia, Europe, all over the world. So I have an idea, but sometimes I think I'm not ready because it's too much. It's too heavy. You know, it's too heavy.
Julie, you asked a question about how do you know. The Bible says out of the mouth of 2 or 3 witnesses, every word is established.
I guess I read the question wrong. Sorry.
So you may run into an encounter where you went to one church and you've not told the pastor that what you think your calling might be. And he may tell you. You may have it could be as simple as a crackhead on the streets to tell you. God can use anybody to tell you. So don't ignore people when they say so to you. You're going to be a minister of God. Don't think that you can't hear from that person. That would be very naive on your part.
Yeah, yeah.
Because God can use anyone.
Oh,
even the least expected. It could be your child out of the mouth of babes. It could be your own children.
Yeah.
So be cautious to listen to the Spirit when the Spirit is trying to move.
Bless you, Nordia, my friend from London. Bless you, girl. Thanks for joining in. Anointed Voices. Thank you guys for joining in. We're just finishing up from listening to you cleared up some questions I had in mind. Oh, wow. Praise
God. Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you so much. And
amen.
We hope to clear up some more issues that the church may be having and some people in general. These questions are really just put out and they're made for y'all because we want people to be safe in the gospel. And in doing things in the gospel that you're not supposed to is a very unsafe place to be.
Very.
Because there's only two sides you can be on.
Yeah.
You can be on Satan's side unknowingly, even unknowingly.
Yeah.
Because some people have a good heart. That don't mean they're bad people. You see people put prophetess up on their page, a prophet. That don't mean that man or woman of God is a bad person.
Yeah.
But they unknowingly working for the wrong kingdom.
Yeah.
So they it's like what we call in error. They're preaching or ministering in error.
Yeah.
So don't make sure that you do that. Make sure out of two or three witnesses, somebody has said that's what you are. Because if not, you're doing it yourself.
Yes. Please pray for me. The calling of God is on my life, but sometimes I'm afraid. Okay. I'll
never be afraid.
Never
Who
be
is
afraid.
This?
That is
Carlene. Carlene, if you have a on your life and God is moving for you, make sure you embrace that. Don't be scared of that. Embrace that. Embrace that.
Amen. Amen. So if you're not a bishop, don't go buy your title on Google for $100 to be a doctor. Doctor this, because everybody has the same title. Don't go buy your title to be a bishop and to be a deacon or an evangelist. Don't go buy your title. Let God anoint you. Let God promote you. Let God elevate you. You know, promotion cometh not from the east nor the west, but from God. That's right. Only the Holy Spirit could teach us, Nordia. Let God anoint you, not because you see prophet and prophetess being popular. Don't go give yourself that title.
Amen, Nordia. She said, I've learned so much from the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
That is who you're supposed
that
to be
is who
from.
You, yeah, that's the master teacher. That is the teacher, the Holy Spirit. Yeah, don't go buy your title offline because it's popular. Wait on God to anoint you and to promote you and elevate you.
Yes.
All right, we're getting off of here. We've been on
Later,
over an hour.
We're going to be a part two. Don't worry.
Yeah, there's going to be a part two because you guys really want it. So thank you guys for all the wonderful comments. Thank you for everyone that has joined in. We love you so much. And we can't wait to see you again. Look out for the flyers on Facebook, guys, because I'm going to be posting them next week. Okay. This week. Sorry, I'm going to be posting them this week. Of when, and I want you guys to tune in on Saturday, 9:30. I'm going to be doing prophetic warfare prayer.
Oh, you have a new title for ministry. Do you want to talk about that?
No.
You want to wait
until the next
thing?
Okay. All right.
No,
don't jump the gun.
Okay. All right.
Okay. So anybody who didn't see this video from the beginning, just go back and rewatch it. Also, make sure on Saturday that everybody tune in. It's powerful. It's anointed. It's prophetic. So many people have given me testimonies of how God has moved through their lives. So if you need a change, if you need a touch from God, Saturday at 9:30 a.m. Morning. Yes, morning. Saturday at 9:30 a.m. Make sure that I see you on. Make sure that you join in to spread this word. Make sure that you invite a friend also. I'm going to be going over everything like how I normally do it, but make sure that you guys all tune in. I love you guys and I appreciate you guys. Thank you so much for joining in, and I'll see you guys on Saturday, 9:30.
Later,
bye, guys.
Thank you so much.
Bye.